Chapter 16. I Will Not Betray My City. "Brothers!" cried Reiner, stepping out of an alley and falling in with seven priests of Mor, who walked a plain casket through the rubble of the merchant district towards the manor district gate. "Do your labors take you to the grand manor this night?" He was dressed in black robes, too, the Blackhearts having just relieved a Morist corpse-burning detail of them not an hour ago.
"Aye, we do, brother," said the lead priest. "A sergeant of the guard has succumbed to the plague, and his superiors wanted him removed without anyone seeing his, malformations."
"Naturally," said Reiner, his heart surging. At last. This was the fourth such procession he had asked the question of, and the midnight hour was fast approaching. He signaled surreptitiously behind him.
"Why do you ask?" asked the priest.
We go the same way," said Reiner. "We thought we might travel together for safety."
"We?"
said the priest, looking around. He shrieked as eight looming figures surged out of the alley and descended upon his fellows.
"One moment, father," said a guard at the Hartgelt gate. "Where are you bound?"
"For the grand manor, my son," Reiner said, as the black-robed Blackhearts came to a halt, their stolen casket held between them. "A sergeant of the guard awaits Moore's gate."
"You have the order of removal?" asked the guard.
He didn't seem eager to stand too close to the casket. "One moment," said Reiner. He withdrew a rolled parchment from the voluminous sleeve. He held it out, but the guard didn't take it.
"Open it, father. No offense meant," he said.
"None taken," said Reiner, and unrolled a scroll, pleased. The more disinclined the guards were to approach servants of Mor, the better the Blackheart's chances. The guard gave the order a cursory glance.
"And the casket?"
"Certainly," said Reiner. He lifted the lid so the guard could see inside. The guard stood on tiptoe so he didn't have to step closer to the casket, and then waved them inside.
"Carry on, father."
"Bless you, my son," said Reiner. The Blackhearts started into the manor district, Gert and Pavel and Hals, moaning and weaving in the throes of savage hangovers. Behind them, Reiner heard the guard mutter,
"They even stink of death."
Reiner smiled, for there was reason for the smell. As they approached the grand manor, Reiner saw Scharnholt and his men entering through the gate. The gate guards saluted them. Reiner held back until they had entered and then approached. There was no sign of Danziger. Reiner hoped he was already inside. It was almost midnight. The scene at the manor district gate was repeated with minor variations here, although the inspection was more thorough, and rather than passing them through, the chief guard assigned them an escort to take them where they had to go, a storeroom near a guardroom in the lower levels of the old barrel keep. Their escort was a sturdy young guard, who seemed less than happy with this duty, and hurried ahead of the Blackhearts as if he were trying to lose them. Reiner did his best to memorize their route, and look for stairs leading down. Their guide took them away from the public areas of the manor, where the nobles might be offended by their presence, and into a maze of service corridors and back stairs. After a while, the hallways became tight passages of undressed stone, and Reiner knew they had entered the old keep. At the bottom of a twisting stair, they passed a guardroom full of guards, talking and playing cards, and then stopped just around the corner of a bolted wooden door with a sleepy guard before it.
"Jaffenberg," said their guide, "you're dismissed. They've come."
"About time," said the guard,
and he took a key from a pouch.
"Never done a duller watch than this."
He handed a key to the guide and saluted.
"See you at Elsa's later."
"Aye, I suppose."
Jaffenberg hurried off as their guide turned the key in the lock and pushed open the door, revealing a narrow storeroom filled with blankets and cakes of soap and jars of lamp oil. Lying on the floor was a dead guard with a second head, small as the fist of a baby, peeking out of his collar next to the first. The guide shivered at the sight.
Poor beggar, treat him well, he was a good man.
Better than we'll treat you, said Reiner.
Eh?
The boy turned and flinched as Reiner put his dagger against his jugular.
What are you?
Gert covered the boy's mouth from behind with one big hand and pinned his sword arm with the other. He walked him backwards into the storeroom as Reiner kept the blade at his throat. The others pushed in behind them. 10 people in the casket made it a very crowded place. Franka could barely close the door.
Now, lad, said Reiner, flashing the dagger in their guide's frightened eyes. Where are the stairs to the lower levels? And know that if you try to scream, you will die as you draw your breath.
He nodded to Gert. Let him speak.
The boy took a breath. He was trembling.
I won't tell you. I'd rather die.
Reiner smiled kindly. Very brave, lad, but are you brave enough to not die?
To not die?
Asked the boy, confused.
Aye, said Reiner. Dying is easy. It's done in a second. But Gert can break a man's neck so that he loses all movement in the limbs and yet he doesn't die. Can you imagine that? Alive in the limb sack of your body, unable to move, feed yourself, or wipe your own arse, or make love to your sweetheart for the next 50 years. Are you brave enough to face that?
I will not betray the Countess, gabbled the boy. I will not betray my city.
Gert twisted the boy's head, steadily increasing the pressure. Are you certain? Asked Reiner. The boy's eyes were rimmed with white. His face was bright red. Gert twisted harder.
To the right, squeaked the boy.
Gert relaxed the pressure.
To the right until you pass the laundry, and then left past the kitchens and down. It's below the storerooms. May Sigmar forgive me.
And may you forgive me, said Reiner, and cracked the boy in the temple with the pommel of the dagger. He sagged in Gert's arms. Right, Reiner said. Tie him up and give me his key. Then get out of these robes. Gert chuckled.
Break his neck so he can't move?
He bent to bind the boy's wrists.
How do you invent these things, Captain?
Reiner shrugged. Desperation.
Bad business, Augustus growled. Hurting an innocent boy.
He was in our way, said Reiner coldly. We had no choice.
No choice but to die, said Augustus.
That is not a choice. There followed a few moments of bumping elbows and muffled curses as the Blackhearts struggled out of their robes in the tight space. Put them in a casket, said Reiner. The arm, too. And leave the masks off for now. We look more suspicious with them on than off. Darius, looking queasy, took a long, lumpy, triple-wrap parcel from a deep pocket in the robe and dropped it with a thud into the casket. Good riddance, he said. When they were ready, Reiner squeezed to the door. A mask like a crow's beak hung from a ribbon around his belt. The others had similar ones. Reiner had bought them from a huckster who claimed they would protect them from madness. Right, he said, grinding out his torch. Dieter, on point. Jürgen at the rear, to the right. He opened the door a crack and looked out as Dieter joined him. A clatter of boots made him close it right back up. He waited until the sound had faded away and then cracked the door again. Raised voices and reflected torchlight came from the guardroom around the left-hand corner, but the hall to the right was clear. Off we go. The Blackhearts followed Dieter into the unlit hall as quietly as they could. Reiner locked the door behind them and took up the rear. After a moment of feeling blindly along the stone walls, Dieter's silhouette became visible again, and they heard women's voices and sloshing water ahead. On the left-hand wall, an open door glowed with yellow light. There was a smell of steam and soap.
He ain't my sweetheart, said a shrill voice.
Now, don't lie, Gertie, cackled another. We saw you making eyes at him. And he do look quite fetching as in uniform, isn't he?
Dieter edged forward until he could see into the door.
He held up a palm, and the others waited.
"So, you fancy him yourself, do you?"
said the first voice.
"Well, he don't like fat old... Oh, now look, this will never come out. That's blood, that is."
Dieter beckoned Reiner across, and he tiptoed past the door, catching a glimpse of a handful of women stirring dirty clothes into boiling iron cauldrons with long wooden paddles. Another darned stockings in a corner. Dieter pointed to the rest of the Blackhearts in turn, and they slipped across the opening one by one. The women never looked up. Just beyond the laundry was the kitchen corridor. Dieter and Reiner looked down it. It was well lit, and voices came from it, rising over the clatter and hiss of a busy kitchen. As they watched, five footmen with large trays on their shoulders walked from a right-hand door and hurried towards a shadowy stair at the far end. A scullery maid crossed the hall, struggling with a huge skillet. Dieter frowned, rubbing his chin.
"A bit more difficult, this one. If we had one of them ratty smoke grenades..."
Reiner shook his head. "I think this calls for brass, not stealth."
"Brass?" asked Dieter.
"Aye." Reiner turned to the others. "Right, lads. Two abreast, weapons on shoulders. Dieter, Darius, do your best." The Blackhearts formed up, Hals and Pavel at the front. "Now," said Reiner, "look like you belong here. March!" He plucked a torch from the wall and started forward with a brisk step. The Blackhearts tramped in unison behind him as if they were on an important duty. Reiner waved back a footman carrying a platter. "Stand clear, fellow." The man led them by with a look of surly patience and then followed after them. Cooks and kitchen assistants glanced up as they passed, but they didn't give them a second look. When they reached the stairwell, Reiner led the Blackhearts down while the footman went up. Reiner breathed a sigh of relief. No one had sensed anything amiss. As the noise of the kitchen faded behind them, sounds came from below, growing louder with each step.
"That's a fight," said Hals.
"Aye," said Pavel. "I hear it."
"On your guard," said Reiner, drawing his sword. "But no need to hurry. Let Danziger and Scharnhold do the dirty work." They continued down the stairs, listening to the melee below as they descended past the storeroom level. Turning down the last flight, they saw shadows fighting in the light cast from a wide archway. Reiner raised a hand, and the Blackhearts halted. "Put your masks on," he whispered. The Blackhearts slipped their black crowbeaks on. Reiner honestly hoped they would not have to fight in them. He had no peripheral vision through the eye holes. As they started down again, a body flew backwards through the archway, spilling blood. A man in a black breastplate followed him and stabbed him in the chest, finishing him off. The killer looked up and jumped as he saw the men on the stairs. It was Danziger.
"Who?"
he gasped and then relaxed.
"Ah, it's you. You're late. Come on, we're in."
They followed him into a low, square room with a stout, iron-bound door in one wall. The place was crowded with Danziger's and Scharnhold's men, busy killing the 12 guards who manned the door. Scharnhold was standing in the center, directing with a casual hand and mopping his round face with a white linen handkerchief. Reiner noticed that men in both Scharnhold's and Danziger's companies had short poles strapped to their backs for carrying the waystone.
"Pederman, the door," Scharnhold said. "Dortig, cut every throat. These men know us. We can have no survivors."
He frowned as Danziger approached him with the Blackhearts.
"Who are these?"
"More of ours," said Danziger. "Servants who do not dare show their faces."
Reiner smiled to himself. Danziger was repeating his words to the letter.
"I see," said Scharnhold, curling his lip. "I hope they can fight as well as serve." "I assure you, my lord," said Danziger, "they are most capable." "I will leave 10 men here," said Scharnhold, as his men opened the door. "With the story that they came upon some cultists slaughtering the gods and chased them away,
then took it upon themselves to guard the door until more guards could be summoned.
Danziger paused, shooting a knowing look at Reiner, before smiling at Scharnhold.
An admirable plan, brother. But let our men share this dangerous duty. I would feel remiss if you took the risk entirely upon yourself.
Scharnhold raised an eyebrow.
Do I sense mistrust, brother? Are we not united as one in this?
Indeed we are, said Danziger, indignant.
It is why I offer to share the danger with you. Perhaps it is you who are mistrustful. Or do I mistake concern for mistrust because you plan treachery? He speaks of treachery, who betrays my followers to Waldenheim and Teclis when we already had the stone?
Asked Scharnhold, putting a hand to his hilt. Danziger did the same. Reiner stepped forwards.
My lords, he said, aping a slurring Talabheim accent to disguise his voice.
Please, remember our purpose here.
He wanted the two lords fighting, but not just yet. Not before they opened the vault for him. Scharnhold let go of his sword.
Your man speaks wisdom. This is not a place to argue. Very well, we will share the duty.
He turned to the door.
The dungeon is on the same level as the vault, and it has its own guards. I will make it so the noise of the battle does not carry, but you must not let the men we fight escape to warn the dungeon guards. Now, let us go.
Chapter 17 Kill Them. As the companies lined up to enter the door, Reiner heard Augustus mutter,
Only doing their job,
under his breath, as he looked around at the dead guards. His fists were balled at his sides, knuckles white. Scharnhold and Danziger both left 10 men behind to hold the door, and led the rest down the steps. The Blackhearts marched in behind them, and started into the depths. The big door boomed closed behind them. Reiner swallowed. No turning back now. At the second landing, Scharnhold began muttering and waving his podgy fingers. The air around Reiner seemed to thicken, and there was a pressure on his eardrums as if he had dived into deep water. The cultists and the Blackhearts were opening their mouths and wiggling their fingers in their ears, trying to clear the pressure, but it wouldn't go.
What is it?
Asked Franca, wincing. Reiner could barely hear her. It sounded like she spoke from behind a thick pane of glass. All the noise around them was damped. The jingle and the creak of the men around him was almost inaudible. The men followed. Their marching made as much noise as a cat walking through grass. It was as if the air had become a jelly and the sounds caught in it. 3 flights down, the stair ended at a wide corridor stretching away into the darkness, other passages intersecting it at wide intervals. Were they still within the halls of the Barrel Keep? Reiner wondered. Surely the corridor carried on further than that. He shook his head. It was a wonder all of Talabheim didn't cave in, considering how much of it was riddled by tunnels. Danziger pointed to a right-hand passage, and the men filed in. It ended at an iron gate, through which they could see torchlight. Scharnhold handed a keyring to Danziger without missing a beat in his mumbling. Danziger turned to the company and gave an order no one could hear. He rolled his eyes in annoyance and brandished his sword with an exaggerated motion. The cultists and the Blackhearts drew their weapons as Danziger turned the key in the lock. It made no noise, nor did the swinging of the gate. Danziger waved forward, and the men rushed into the room as silent as a breeze. Reiner took in the room as he ran. It was a vaulted rectangular chamber, longer than it was wide, with archways to the left and the right, and 10 guards standing in a line against a massive stone door at the far end, which was bound with iron bands. The guards shouted in surprise as they saw the cultists. Their voices barely sounded in Scharnhold's bubble. They drew their weapons and met the charge valiantly, but they were far too few. Danziger's and Scharnhold's men quickly chopped them to pieces in a horrible silent bloodbath. Reiner and the Blackhearts hung back and took no part. Nonetheless, Reiner felt shame.
was standing aside to let good men be killed less villainous than swinging the sword yourself? Augustus was swearing out loud. Fortunately, no one could hear him.
The keys, said Danziger, shouting to be heard.
One of Danziger's men handed him two keys. One of Scharnhold's men had another. But as he turned to the door, more than a score of guards poured out of two archways, charging the cultist's rear.
Kill them all, cried Danziger, though it came out as a whisper. Let none escape.
Scharnhold stepped back to the door as the cultists turned to face their enemies. He could give no orders, for he had to maintain the incantation. The two sides clashed together with almost no sound, mouths opened like mummers, miming shouts and screams. Augustus glared at the backs of the cultists as they fought the guard, his hands gripping his spear as if he were about to attack. Reiner put a hand on his shoulder. The pikeman snarled and pulled away. The others looked nearly as mutinous. Reiner didn't blame them. There was nothing for it. They had to get a stone. He stepped to Danziger and shouted almost inaudibly to his ear.
My lord, give us the keys and defend us, and my men will open the vault so that we may be away all the quicker.
Aye, said Danziger. Good, and make the stone ready to carry as well.
Of course, my lord, said Reiner. His heart leapt. The fool gave him more than he even asked for. Reiner collected the keys and the poles from the men who carried them and motioned the Blackhearts to the door as Danziger's and Scharnhold's men formed a protective semicircle around them, hacking and thrusting at the maddened guards. He gave keys to Franca, Darius, and Dieter, and then yelled at the others. Watch their back. They nodded and faced out towards the melee, standing behind Danziger's men, all of them but Augustus, who only glared, spear at his side, at the carnage. Although they were not invulnerable, as Scharnhold's men had been in the Ratman caves, many of the cultists wore amulets written over with vile runes. Reiner saw a guardsman's sword veer away from a cultist's head, as if pushed aside by an invisible hand. The keyplate was set into the floor before the vault door, an oblong steel plaque decorated with geometric patterns. Franca, Darius, and Dieter knelt over it. The designs framing each keyhole were different. One was a square, one was a circle, and one was a diamond, which corresponded to the backs of the three keys. Dieter shook his head as he inserted them into the locks.
This is dwarf work, he shouted to Reiner. Glad you didn't tell me to pick it.
He looked at the others.
Now, all together, or we'll have to go again.
Franca, Darius, and Dieter slowly turned the keys, and they hit home together. Reiner felt a heavy clunk under the floor. Dieter smiled.
It's the prettiest sound in the world.
Reiner checked the battle. The guards were surrounded now, and falling fast. He slapped the backs of Hals, Pavel, Gert, Augustus, and Jürgen.
Get here! Push!
They turned and pushed on one of the massive stone doors. At first it didn't move, and Reiner momentarily feared they hadn't unlocked them at all, but then it slowly swung in. When the gap widened enough to walk into, Reiner waved a halt. Pavel and Hals gathered up the poles and rope, and the Blackhearts filed into the vault. The faint sounds of the battle faded entirely beyond the door. They stopped and gaped in wonder. The torch of Augustus glittered over 1,000 golden treasures. There were 20 gilded chairs and jeweled silver armor with a dragon helm. Swords with gold-chased scabbards and gemstone pommels sprouted like flowers from a cafe vase. Beautiful paintings and statues and tapestries were piled everywhere. Caskets and chests lined each wall. The waystone was standing among a grove of beautiful marble statues, looking out of place among them.
Nice hall, shouted Dieter. Would like to have a peek in those chests, too.
We're not here for that, said Reiner.
Unfortunately.
He pointed them to the waystone. Get it ready. Once Scharnhold and Danziger defeat the guards, I'll try to turn them against each other, and then we will kill the survivors.
Sigmar be praised, said Hals.
"About damn time," said Augustus.
The others nodded in agreement. They moved to the waystone and began to tip it down on the poles.
"Wait," called Franca suddenly. "Wait, I have a better idea."
"Eh?" said Augustus. "There ain't a better idea than killing them cursed demon lovers."
"It will be better if we survive and escape, aye?"
snapped Franca. "What's the idea, lass?" bellowed Reiner. Franca started to explain, but Reiner couldn't hear her.
"What? You have to shout."
Frustrated, Franca pointed to a statue of a buxom nymph next to the waystone, which was roughly the same height and circumference, and then to a rolled rug. Reiner laughed. It was a brilliant plan. They could get out without a fight.
"Yes, good."
He waved to the others, shouting. "Hide the stone and wrap that instead. Quickly, Jürgen, let no one in." Reiner helped Hals, Pavel, Augustus, and Gerd carry the waystone behind the stand of statues, as Franca and Darius unrolled a rug and draped it over the statue.
"Will it work?" shouted Gerd, as they lowered the wrapped statue onto the poles.
Reiner shrugged.
"If it doesn't, you'll get your fight."
Gerd grinned at that. They bound the statue to the poles, making sure that the ropes made it impossible to pull back the rug and see underneath.
"Good," said Reiner when it was secure. "Get it up. If it all goes wrong, kill Scharnhold and Danziger first."
He looked out as the others raised the wrapped statue. They were just in time, too. The cultists were killing the last of the gods and wiping their blades. Scharnhold stopped the incantation and turned towards the vault with Danziger. Reiner's ears popped, and the sound dashed again into his head, battering his eardrums. Boot heels on flags, the laughter of the cultists, the moans of the dying were suddenly unbearably loud. Reiner beckoned the Blackhearts forward and then stepped out, waved at Danziger and Scharnhold.
"My lords, we have it."
The Blackhearts edged the covered statue through the partially open stone door. Reiner's palms were sweating. This was a dangerous moment. If the lords wanted to see the stone, then they were in trouble. If they asked the Blackhearts to carry it, that was troubling as well.
"Lead on, my lords," he said with a wave of his hand. "We will carry the stone."
"Eh?" said Danziger, suddenly suspicious. "You will carry the stone?"
"What does he say?" said Scharnhold. "Does your servant order us?"
"Your men have been fighting," said Reiner. "We are fresh and strong. We have it well in hand."
Danziger and Scharnhold exchanged a look and then turned back to Reiner.
"No, brother," Danziger said. "We will carry the stone. Since your fellows are fresh and unheard, you will guard our backs in case we are followed."
Reiner shrugged and bowed, hiding a smile.
"As your lordship wants it."
He motioned for the Blackhearts to put down the stone. After some argument, Scharnhold and Danziger agreed that their men would carry the stone together, and the party got underway, traveling without torches. As they neared the passage to the dungeons, Scharnhold resumed his muttering and silence again closed around them. Reiner looked down the corridor as they passed it. Not far down, he saw the shadows of bars and the moving men in a square of light cast across the floor. The main corridor dimmed into darkness beyond the dungeon passage. Scharnhold changed incantations and led away with a faint blue light, which flickered above his outstretched palm. The back of the column was in total darkness. Reiner motioned the Blackhearts to slow their steps, and by the time they reached the stairs to the bowels of the manor, they lagged 20 paces behind. They descended 2 flights in darkness, and then Reiner stopped, listening. When no query came from below, he whispered, "Back, to the stone, quietly." The Blackhearts padded back up the steps, then along the corridor towards the torchlight. They slowed at the hole to the dungeons and crept past it. He waved them by. Augustus scraped his spear butt on the flagstones as he passed, and it made a horrendous noise to their oversensitive ears. Reiner wondered if he had done it on purpose. When no reaction came from the dungeon corridor, they pressed on to the vault room. It was just as they had left it, the vault door ajar, the bodies of the dead guards lying in spreading pools of blood. They hurried across the chamber, taking off their masks and snatching off four spears with which to carry the stone. They entered the vault, and Haus, Pavel, Gert, and Jürgen covered the stone with another rug and lashed it to the spears while the others watched, nervous. Dieter was wandering around the room, examining the treasures. But just as they lifted it, they heard movement from the guard chamber.
"Sigmar, what's this?" cried a voice. "Captain, the vault!"
"Blast it," said Reiner, and rushed into the chamber, sword out. But the guard was already in the hole, screaming at the top of his lungs. Reiner was about to race after him when he stopped. He darted back into the vault and gestured at the Blackhearts. "Set it down and stay hidden." He returned to the guard chamber. Voices and footsteps were approaching from the hole. He dropped and rolled in a puddle of blood, smearing it across his face, then flopped back as if dead, just as a captain and 10 dungeon guards ran in. The captain stared.
"Sigmar, this is impossible! How did we not hear?" "And the vault is open, captain," said the first guard. "Maybe they who did this are..."
Reiner spasmed up, groaning artistically.
"The thieves!" he said. "They..."
He looked around blindly for a moment as the guards turned to look at him and then flung out his hand.
"Captain! Cultists! They've stolen something! They took it to the basement and mean to do some strange magic with it! If you hurry, you might catch them!"
Reiner had hoped, prayed in fact, with fingers crossed to Ranald, that the captain would run off after the thieves in a screaming panic. But the cursed stoic barely raised an eyebrow.
"Jaeger," he said, "take 2 men into the cellar and see what's what. Krieghelm, tell the boys up top the vault's been breached. Tell them von Falzen is needed. The rest stay with me. The vault cannot remain unguarded."
The men raced off. Reiner groaned.
"But, captain," he said, "there were more than 30 of them. 3 men are not going to be enough."
"Nor will 15, said the captain, "which is all I have."
He turned to the vault, motioning to his remaining men.
3 of you, with me."
Reiner watched in horror as the captain and his 3 men started for the open vault.
"No, beware," he cried. "They use some terrible magic to open the door. It is too dangerous."
The captain ignored him and entered the vault, torch high. Reiner cursed, knowing what was coming. He got to his feet, still pretending to be hurt, and edged anxiously towards the door.
"Ho!" came the captain's voice. "Stand forward, you!"
Something heavy smashed. The guards in the chamber looked around, surprised. Reiner ran into the vault and came upon a frozen tableau. The captain and his 3 men were on guard, a toppled suit of armor at their feet, facing the Blackhearts, who stood in a dark corner beyond the waystone, swords out.
"Captain, wait," said Reiner, though what he meant to say after that he had no idea.
"Guards, to me," called the captain. "The thieves are here."
Reiner cursed.
"Kill them," he said.
"Reiner, no," cried Franka.
But when the captain lunged for Reiner, she came forwards with the rest. Only Augustus and Darius hung back, Darius hiding behind a stack of paintings, Augustus staring, mouth agape. Reiner parried the captain's thrust, and the man died with Jürgen's longsword in the back. His other 3 men went down an instant later, impaled by Pavel and Hals's spears, and butchered by the other swords. But as they fell, 9 more rushed into the vault. They cried out as they saw their captain dead and ran around the statues at the Blackhearts, who spread out to meet them.
"No!" cried Augustus. "No, you damn traitor! I won't stand for it!"
He lowered his spear and charged right at Reiner.